One year later, this is all that is left of what once was billed as the showplace of the nation. Soon, the site will be leveled, with no physical presence of the almost Hollywood-like setting, which was Beverly Hills. The cabaret room featured the top stars of show business. Meetings and dinners regularly filled the club's many other rooms. And in recent years, Beverly was the site of frequent weddings. There was nothing quite like it outside Las Vegas. The club was packed on that night of death for a performance by singer John Davidson. Exactly how many people were at Beverly that night never has been established, but it apparently was well above the legal occupancy limit of 1,600. At about 8:45 or 8:50, club employees discovered a fire in the Zebra Room off the main area. It was electrical in origin and had apparently been burning for some time in the concealed spaces behind the ceilings and walls. Employees tried to put it out and sounded the alarm. The word never got to the cabaret room until sometime later when a busboy made the announcement. The evacuation was orderly. At the Zebra Room, the fire that had been building up behind the facade, by that time it built up so much heat that the room and all its furnishings literally exploded into flames, sending dense smoke and hot gases flying down the corridor to the cabaret room, which was packed. The flames soon followed, consuming paneling and carpeting, further adding to the smoke and fumes. When the smoke began rolling into the cabaret room, panic set in. Survivors say there was a mass rush for the two exits on the Alexandria Pike side of the club. The other exits were soon cut off by the fire in the corridor. Those still inside were quickly overcome by the fumes. This series of photographs was taken by Joseph Lalonde of Springfield, a cabaret room patron, whose party left before the panic set in. Firemen quickly abandoned any hope of saving the building and concentrated on getting victims out and reviving them. The effort continued as the fire spread throughout the building, consuming virtually the entire structure. Finally, at around 10:20, all firefighting and rescue personnel were ordered out, and the true dimensions of the tragedy began sinking in. It was a night of horror. John Davidson, who escaped the fire, still won't talk about it. His music arranger was among the fatalities. Davidson was among hundreds of people who showed up at the hospitals that night for word on loved ones. But by then, it was painfully obvious that hospital care was too late for scores of people. The Fort Thomas Armory became the temporary morgue. Jim Cavanaugh returned 1 year later.
The things I remember most about that day include the long line of hearses that came up to the back door here, the contingent of young people, teenagers, who helped out with the unloading of bodies into the morgue for identification. But the one impression that will last the longest with me, at least, is that of all of the families of the deceased coming in and going through rows of bodies to identify their loved ones.
165 died in the fire, hundreds escaped, but many suffered deep mental anguish. Captain Peter Sabino, a 22-year veteran of the Cincinnati Fire Department, was in the main corridor waiting to get into the cabaret room when the staff passed the word. Sabino and his family got out safely. Then Sabino went back and helped in the rescue effort. He's gotten many awards for bravery in the past year, but that's not his most vivid memory.
I had a hold of a woman, and just about at the time when I had as much as I could take, and I had to leave her. That's the big thing.
But there wasn't anything that you could have done?
No, really. Just had to get out.